build system. The first pages, I'll jump a bit fast about those because I think we have them. We have had a couple of changes during the last year. We have our existing build system, that's clear. We have ongoing projects. We have for build, we have the capstone project, which I think you're aware of. Or we have my project, Build Rest in Peace, which was silently killed. We also have LibreOffice, which has actually completed their makefile conversion. And then we have the game file, and then I have some ideas to where can we combine all those things to jump this one. Why change? You all know that. Current system is a mixture of Perl, GNU Make, DMake, and even old experts. I think as a newbie, I've made more changes than some of the old experts because I didn't know how difficult it was. It is non-readable. It's not. You can't maintain the current system in essence. And most important to me is actually we don't have Micro Visual Studio support. Why is that important to me? It's because most of our downloads go to the Windows world. And the Windows world has a heck of a lot of developers which we can't access because we have a build system that scares them away. I can't persuade a Windows developer to use our system, or very seldomly persuade them. So we need good Visual Studio support. We are also not accepted by the Linux providers because we don't fit into their build system. I don't see that as a high priority, but I might be wrong. Changes like what I've done with GameLang is next to nearly impossible to integrate. I integrated in 3 modules that took me 2 evenings. And I have about 70 modules to do, so calculate. It is partly changed to GBuild. That doesn't make life easier because it means some modules is working one way, other modules the other way. So a build system, as we have it now, consists of 3 steps. The initials, or 3 initial steps, we run autoconfigure, we run configure. Those are standard in Linux. They are not standard in Windows. Then we have a special thing which I have never understood, which is Bootstrap. I've never understood why it's not part of configure. Probably never will. I'll just jump a little. It's history, yeah. Now, for every build, for every module, BuildPL is our central Perl script that is essentially a central makefile. But does everything a little bit strange. It looks in every module in a project called PRJ for a build list and a distribution list. And depending on the content of the build list, it calls DMake. And now, if it's one of the modules that converted to GBuild, one should think that we write it in here. No. We have a make file, so BuildPL calls DMake that calls or uses a DMake make file to call a new make make file and do the job. Now, if you are lost, I understand it. When I had to explain that to the Capstone project students, they were sort of, are you kidding me? But this is actually what's happening. And it's that it takes for on my server back. Yes. We have two. There are 2 basic problems. The one is, of course, it's grown by history and was broken off. It's sad as it is. The second one is, for some reason, the make system or the build system of OpenOffice has always been targeted at Linux. And Windows have been a side effect of it. Look what you have to install, Cygwin, and what do I know to get it running. So, what are our current build problems? We have no make for Linux. Every Linux developer will expect he goes into the main directory, says make, and it's done. Not there. We don't have solution files for Windows. The build list and dlist are really OpenOffice specialities. DMake is no longer standard Unix. We build local in a module, have the object files in the module, and then, by God, at the end of the build job, we copy it to a central directory. That's causing performance loss. We mix DMake and GMake. We have a performance penalty at the moment just due to these factors, where we are 2 to 3 times slower on Linux than what we should be. And we are 10 to 12 times slower on Windows than we should be. On my server back home, which is a pretty fast server, it takes me 4 hours to do a complete rebuild in Linux. And it takes 9 hours in Windows. I have tested now with simple make files. If I get rid of all this and have simple make files, I'm down to rebuilding in Linux and Windows in about an hour. Yeah, okay, then it's more for. We have 11 levels of include in our make files. In SVL, which is the hardest one, we are down to 11 levels. We have 122 helper files. I've found out 2 handfuls I know what are doing. The rest, they're sitting there. Yes? They have made, for instance, they have helper files. The make file itself is pretty easy, doesn't contain a lot. But then it includes a lot of small snippets. You would actually call them snippets to make whatever is needed to make. Yes. You can see it here. It's actually, if you're good, it's understandable. But we have a lot of if, and if, and, because we target all platforms in all make files. Instead of what would be natural, if I have those helper files, I would have one helper file for Windows, one for Linux 64-bit, one for Linux 32-bit. No. In every helper file, we have if for dependencies, even cascaded ifs. And on top of that, we have parameter substitution out here. It not only does it not make it readable, but it's also cost a hell of a lot of CPU time. Because a little thing like this one, this is actually calculated every time the make file is processing this line. And if it's a helper file, it's processed a hell of a lot of times during a total build. I did one simple change. I took one helper file, took out all these variable substitutions, took out all the if statements, and I saved about 5% of the build time. Okay, it was a central helper file, but it still gives an indication what we can gain by changing. Another one, actually you two are probably say, this is quite understandable. This is actually our build list, saying in this case that you go down into StarMath include, you run nmake, and you depend on. Wait a second, this is actually what we have make files for. Make files describe dependencies, but OpenOffice has its own syntax for that. So what are we doing about it? We actually, the star math is because we still have a star math module. We have one module called star math. I'm not sure what it does. I got about a little half a year ago, I was approached by the Oregon University because we have, at Infra, we have a very big installation at OSUSL. And they wanted, they have a lot of students who have to do a big project to finalize to get their degree. And I put up a project, actually without talking to very many people. I discussed it with Andrew Rist and sort of said, okay, I put up a project. Let a target of the project is convert our current build system into a Visual Studio solution. I want to have a Visual Studio solution. When I open it, I see all OpenOffice files, and when I press build, it generates whatever needs to be generated. Sort of, that's the target of the project. Status is actually that they have successfully converted two handfuls of modules at the moment. So we have a way of doing it now. They are right now scripting it to convert simple modules. They have an exam in June. I'm pretty sure they are not going to reach their target to deliver me a solution file for all of OpenOffice. But I'm also sure that they will give me and give us as a community enough information about how to do this that we have the stones to build on. And that's actually, that's the real target I have for this project, but I can't tell the students that because then they'll lower the target. It's actually get rid of the makefiles, get rid of Cygwin, use Microsoft Visual Studio to build. Yeah. So it's actually quite a high-level target. But we are getting there. Or can get one. It might take 3 months.
But you know, and it makes sense to have build makes that are on the native, like the Mac make should be native.
Yeah. In about 5 slides, I'll tell you how we get it all together again. Because right now I'm splitting it. I'm making one for Windows and forgetting Linux. In this world, I'm just talking Windows. The next part,
I'll just explaining this in detail.
The next project we have ongoing is a little pet of mine that I want to get rid of BuildPL. But sadly enough, there was a PMC discussion that took this a bit off target. The idea is to take BuildPL as it is, replace it by one central makefile, which every Linux developer expects. Create a build system, by doing this, creating a build system that's acceptable by distributions. There are two things that disturb distributions, or three things at the moment. One is that we use BuildPL, we don't have a central build file. Second is that we have a process called bootstrap, which should be part of configure. And the third thing is our external libraries, but that's sort of a separate case where we need to go through and say, can't we use what is the part of Ubuntu or part of the Linux system? We say as OpenOffice, which I think is a bad choice, we say we need to have everything in our source tree, including the third party. we could just as well do as other packages do and have prerequisites. Say, please, before you start making this system, you need to make sure you have this and this installed. Every Unix or every Linux distribution does that. So it's, and then the Linux distribution system, apt-get or whatever, takes care of solving that, not our problem. It is still expected that we will have something in summer. It depends at the moment whether I can convince our release manager, because I have a strong discussion with our release manager that he wants to have all the features that the old build PL has needs to be in the make file. And, well, it was because I didn't. Sorry, it was not the title. It was because I don't want to hang out names.
So we won't mention their
No, but on.
So one question: Have you thought of just maintaining a parallel build system for a period of time?
There will be a parallel build system until everybody is convinced that the new system works. It's entirely, it's decoupled.
Right. And then you're saying, and here I want to just have the things that are wanted by the distros.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, you've described why it is that the current one is in some ways dysfunctional because it's trying to solve both of those things simultaneously. It's trying to both be a Linux build and a Windows build. Now on the Windows, you want to collect all these things and build them into the install because the expectation is the install is going to put down all the stuff you need.
Yeah.
Whereas the expectation on the Linux side is you'll have dependencies and those things are available as dependencies, which they are on Windows as much.
That's right. One thing.
So being able to make a different decision on each side may actually be more of a feature than
But if you talk about keeping build PL and a central makefile in parallel, that's a little bit harder because we need to go down in every module then and rename the makefiles. Because a central makefile will call for a one makefile in each module and not the old build list. But I can do that by renaming. So my intention is, and it's actually partly running on my computer right now, is that I rename all the make files. Easy done. BuildPL calls the new make file name. Easy done. And the new make files are for the new system. But they are Linux targeted. So in essence, we will for a short time have BuildPL, existing build system, a Windows, which is experimental, and a central makefile, which is. Yeah. Yeah, and I've never committed to trunk before everybody is satisfied. It will be done in a branch, no doubt about it. The big thing is that we make a clear difference. We have in main one makefile that has one sole purpose. That handles inter-module dependencies. Nothing more, nothing less. And then in the module, we have one make file, and that handles that module. And it doesn't know if the other modules was rebuilt or not. It doesn't care about other modules. Today, we have a mixture. Build list actually contains dependencies of other modules. So if you stand in a module and say build, you might have that it goes out and builds another module. I'm in this module. I don't like this. And that's why I want this clear distinction. So that's that project. Yeah, we have the main make file. It's actually due to you, Andrew. I've made that we have a mod. You can say make and a module name, and it will, for convenience, go down. You don't need to be down in the directory. So extras, what else is, Bootstrap should be integrated in Configure. Bootstrap, it's still a script, but Configure calls it. We will have a new Configure switch, which is called Platform. Or my suggestion is Platform. My idea is it's another thing I have a problem with. We have a source tree, and in the source tree, we have our object files as well. But that means if I want to have a debug version and a release version, and maybe that in Linux and Windows, I have to have the source tree n times. I don't like that. I want to have one source tree, and when I change in that, it's changed for all the platforms I work on. So I can't have a target directory unixlang.pro. I need to be able to, in my build, to specify what's my target language or target directory. And this is actually this new switch. The whole idea is to get rid of all our environment variables. At the moment, Configure, you have to run after what you have to run this, unix, lng.pro.shell, whatever, to set all the environment variables. That's nasty. And somebody might think build boxes, because it will help our build boxes a lot. But also developers sitting who are actually doing a debug version and a production version. So the idea is get rid of all the variables and only have one variable, the platform. The name is something we can change. Build type is the next thing we will have, which is new. But it basically says, OK, I'm doing this for Windows, or I'm doing it for Ubuntu. We have a similar one today. Then we'll have predefined configurations. All you need to say is configure --- release, and it will set the switches as our releases. I don't need to document that I have 10 or 15 switches at the moment. And this is basically, it's easy stuff. So the next system I've been looking carefully at is LibreOffice. They have actually done quite a good job of making a solid makefile system. It works, and it's nice. It's totally Linux, and they get problems with Windows with what they have done. So they are focused. But the idea is, actually, we have no license issue with makefiles. They have not put a license in their makefiles. So there's nothing legally that prohibits us from taking those makefiles and put them in our system. No, and we won't. What we will do is, of course, we will look at the LibreOffice make files, and they are different than ours, and we will adapt them so that they fit to ours, and then it's contributed by us. I couldn't do that if the makefile had a license in, I would be violating. But because the makefile doesn't have a license in, I, as a committer, can take that file, adapt it to our needs, and put it in our system. It's not a copy. Something like we have done with Cygwin. The last I've seen is they built on they can build on Windows, but that's using Cygwin. Yeah. But for their production, they built on Linux with a cross compiler. Digital signing is, at FOSDEM I gave a presentation about digital signing, which I'm also involved in.
Was there a prediction on digital signing for date?
The date depends on when I get one or two people to help me do it. I know what we have to do, but I don't have the capacity to do it myself. I have the, okay, as a person, I have the advantage that I sold my companies 2 years ago. So I can put in the time I need to put in and I want to put in. But on the other hand, as all of you have seen, I do what I like to do, and what I don't like to do is, I might learn in the future to say it a bit softer, but this is actually... this is actually a nice project for a new developer. And if, for instance, Rob, with your advertisements or announcements, if we could get a developer in who were interested, I would have no problems guiding that developer. But I try to focus on initiating those things, and when it gets down to, say, now you have to do it for 100 modules. I would like to have somebody who can help me, and by helping me, learning our system. So no timeline for this. Gimlang, as you heard early on, removed the current extract merge process. It adds language dependencies, and it changed build all to include all languages. We still have an open discussion whether how our releases should be, but I am totally in favor for that our executable, our OpenOffice executable, contains all released languages. The difference in size is about 40 megabyte. The rest of the difference, and that's huge, is the dictionaries. And we should be able to make something very easy that says, do I want to include the dictionaries? But a lot of users, I think a lot of users, they wouldn't mind having multiple languages and the feature of being able to switch very fast between them. We did something for them from Infra about a month ago. We gave them access to a new server where they have a pretty good upload. And then they sort of... that's clearly one of the things I'm thinking about. I just want to say, in general, we have multiple languages in our executable.
Just always keep in mind, what is it going to look like when we have 100 languages? If we were to design this, the thing that you do is you download core and the install goes and gets the other pieces that you want, right? And so what you would have is you might have a small install bootstrap for each configuration.
Yeah. But we have to deviate from one thing. We have to deviate from one thing. We don't have a one-click download anymore then. But the whole world has a two-click download. You download the little installer. That determines what is to be downloaded next, so you have two downloads. Yet today... Yeah, that's exactly what I've been told a lot of times. We need to do one download that contains it all. That's what our users want. I don't understand it, but I've heard it many times.
5 years ago, distributing on CD was a major form of distributing open
office. Yeah, but
what about, you know, places out that don't have the internet connection anymore? Is that no longer
So one of the pieces here is if you go and look, and there are a lot of products that have that type of download, and all they have is they have a, what is my source? Where am I getting the bits from? And it's normally configured in such a way that you can either get them from a base URL or from a file URL. Okay. And so when you yep. take all the bits, put them on a CD, ship the CD, and then as you run the install, instead of going and looking at a web...
It go to files. Yes.
And the best part about it is, instead of having to put 30, 40, 50, 100, 160 meg installs on that, you put all the pieces on there and it all works together. But again, I nominate someone else to do the work on
it.
So, how does it all come together? Now I've shown you the pieces that are in progress, more or less. But what's the target idea? I should say we had a good session at FOSDEM where I spoke a lot with the people from Hamburg and we exchanged a lot of ideas. And that mixed with my own ideas gave us this slide where we say we want to remove Cygwin. That's a sick idea to have on Windows. We want to have simple, but remark, generated makefiles for the distros. So what I'm implying here is that we don't have one makefile for Solaris, Ubuntu, and whatever. No, we have something, I'm coming to it in a second, that when you say, I have this platform, it generates the makefiles, so I don't have if dependencies and everything in there. I have makefiles specifically for what I need. Remove environment variables, really. That's whack. All in a file instead. So I have this platform variable before, so now I have a file that contains what I need. End of day. Clear separation between source and generated files. I want to have a source directory, which is a copy of what I have in subversion. And then everything that is changeable or generated or whatever is in a second directory. That's also easier now to have multiple instances of the second directory. And to clean it up, yes.
Is this generated make calls also
It's for sure BSD and free, the free BSD in this case. For Mac, I need somebody to help me because I have no experience in Mac. But what I've been told is that the makefiles which we have in Linux is basically the same makefiles in Mac. There are just some small diversions or differences. Main point is the new build system needs to be easy to maintain. Okay. So now we come to the changes. Autoconf, configure and bootstrap grows into a setup for Windows. So we have a setup not for the end user, but for the developers. And we have a only configure for Windows. Bootstrap goes away, and we define set of dependencies. You can actually also now, with install shield in Windows, define dependencies, and it will control it. Only two environment variables, AO platform and AO build. That's it, a new directory structure. So now we are getting close, but not really. The idea is to make it like this. I have my source tree, which is identical to Subversion. It contains a build directory with everything we need for building. It contains extras, and it contains main. And one of my pets is also extras is not languages. They are in here, but it's a minor detail. And then it contains the modules, and it contains not a makefile, but a recept. I don't have a better English word for it. But it's a file that describes how to generate the makefiles. Actually, we are discussing of making that as an XML file. But in that recept would be the list of source files. Do we need libraries? Are we depending a little bit of the old build list?
Does it also have the
Linux
OS dependent?
Yes. This one is universal. So it will have one general section, and then you can override per platform. Yes. Then we have the target, which can be multiple. It has its build, it has the generate and make files, and the main with all the object modules, libraries, and whatever. So we have a clear separation of those two. This is just a description of it. The generated makefiles, it's important to understand that they are really simple. I don't have the snippet. I don't have my sol env include directory anymore because it's generated, so they are targeted as they should be. And the initial test is that we save 70 to 80% of the current build time, 10 to 15%. No, sorry, we're down to 7 to 80% of the current time, but we are a factor 10 better in Windows. Now is the big problem. I have two requests. We need developers who are willing to help on this. This is a matter of resources. This is no longer a matter of design or strategy. We have all the bolts and nuts we need to make this happen, but we need people who can help do it. And we need a developer list that is more a developer mailing list than it's a talk nice list. I need a list where developers can talk development. To put it where. The other Apache projects I know, the dev list is really technical.
Well, so one of the things that you can do here is if you just get smart about your packages and your libraries, you know, the square tags, it becomes
I
was going to say all the noise. All of the issues coming to the dev mailing list that are not necessarily important to you. So you filter all that out, and then you can just look at the ones with build, and you basically have your own mailing list, but as a subpiece. And it would be exactly, yes.
I've been talking to a couple of Windows developers I happen to know, and they are concerned about the number of mails on the dev list. They would actually prefer a forum. And that's another way that if we had a couple of developers that we made a development forum. I still agree every decision needs to be on the dev list. There's no doubt about that. But the discussion whether you use string or whether you use character and such should be on somewhat dedicated once we have the developers. But
that's why I'm suggesting is that you can even try and do that, and then have this sub project that's being very good about managing all of their messages, having a tag and being on the dev list, but being an easily filterable sub content. It actually provides something both for the project in general, and it allows you to do this work.
Do this, yeah. My main problem is how do we get developers? Yeah, but it's a real catch-22.
So here's the question: What is your startup time? I mean, do you really want to ramp this up at the end of your capstone project?
No.
Or are you looking to ramp it up now?
I want to have a new build system in place end of the year.
So we can always have. So for recruitment, I've done a number of blog posts, the project blog.
Or convert the central make file and. Actually, that's how I got the 4 students at the university. They were thrilled of the chance of building something new, not just, as we spoke on earlier, not just small add-ons, but really, I can change something.